Hello, hola, labas, brevit, ni hao, privet, and warm welcome to everyone. Warm welcome to my presentation, the how and why of learning Sanskrit. My name is Olga. I come originally from Ukraine, but for a few years now I've been living in Berlin and I've been traveling a lot and studying in different countries. Switzerland, England. I've been living for a few years in Amsterdam, and wherever I go, I try to learn the native tongue and understand people. But I also have a special interest in languages, namely in dead languages, not spoken anywhere in the world. And I'm so excited about these dead languages that I decided to study historical linguistics. A few years ago, I finished my bachelor's degree in historical linguistics here in Berlin at Humboldt University in Berlin. And now I am tutoring Sanskrit courses at university and also courses in Indo-European linguistics. I'm specializing in Indo-European languages and I studied a few of them. Latin, Old Church Slavonic, Old Lithuanian, Hittite, Hieroglyphic Luwian, and Sanskrit, the topic of today's presentation. So, the how and why of Sanskrit, I will begin with why study Sanskrit and then proceed to how study Sanskrit, what materials are available for study of this language, and how to proceed if you're interested in studying this language. And first of all, what is Sanskrit? Sanskrit is an ancient language of India, and it is primarily an educational language. It is an Indo-European language, and it belongs to the Indo-Aryan branch of the Indo-European family of languages. It is a little bit similar like Latin in Europe. It is language of science and education, but also of major religious scriptures. Three religions, Hinduism, Buddhism, and Jainism, rely on this language. And it was not only important in India, but throughout Southeast Asia and all the way north up to China. It had a status of a classical language. And due to this special status of the kind of language of scholarly elite, it was a major source of loan words for a number of languages spoken in Asia. It is not really spoken nowadays, but according to Ethnologue, there are users and even 5 million users of Sanskrit in India, where it is also recognized as the official language, one of the 22 official languages in India. And Sanskrit is a collective term for a number of ancient languages spoken in India from 1500 BC, approximately. And till today, it has a special status in India, and many people learn it. Many people who go to university have to learn Sanskrit, and also people who are not necessarily philologists or linguists. So it originated, it kind of developed in India after the Indo-European peoples traveled to the north of India, where they settled down, and they spread a little bit more to the south throughout the Indian subcontinent, but not just quite in the south. The Dravidian languages were spoken here. And it spread its influence around the whole of Asia almost. And it was primarily due to the spread of Buddhism that many Sanskrit terms entered other languages. But also the spread of Indian culture and Indian thought and philosophy led to the fact that many, many languages borrowed Sanskrit terms and also viewed Sanskrit as a special language. So why study Sanskrit? It is not only fascinating because of its status as a special language, as a language of classical literature and classical thought. Knowledge of Sanskrit grants access to an enormous body of literature. So I cannot talk about every single genre of literature, but I will mention a few things that I personally find fascinating. So first of all, the four Vedas. Veda, probably you've heard about the Rig Veda. It is the oldest of the four. It is the oldest transmitted text from India. And it is seen by Hinduists as a text where all the sacred knowledge of the ancient sages is collected. And after an extensive meditation and after reaching a state of Nirvana, those sages wrote down the sacred knowledge. And quite interesting about the Vedas is that the Vedas were written not all at the same time. They are very big, but they were already written in the second millennium before Christ. They were composed in the second millennium before Christ, but they were not written down for a very long time and for centuries. They were just transmitted orally with the use of extremely elaborate mnemonic techniques. And that makes them quite special. Also, another text I would like to mention is Panchatantra. Panchatantra is a collection of fables, and it is much older than what we knew in Europe, the animal fables that were transmitted by Greeks and written by Romans. And this collection of fables, it's quite fascinating because it was translated in so many different languages. Already in the ancient times, the Persians, the Greeks, the Romans, they were aware of the existence of Panchatantra. And this collection of stories about animals was very popular back in the day already. There also exists drama and poetry, especially Kalidasa is the most famous author who wrote many dramas that were also popular in Europe. Goethe, for example, made use of very many tropes that were originally created by Kalidasa. Also, I must say, it is a little bit questionable because lots of things are attributed to Kalidasa, and nowadays it's a little bit hard to say if Kalidasa really wrote all of the poetry that is being attributed to him. Yeah, the next point, the epics, Mahabharata and Ramayana. Those are the two epics in Sanskrit. They're extremely famous and they're enormous. Mahabharata alone is 8 times as large as everything that has been attributed to Homer. So it's really huge. And Ramayana is also quite a long epic. It tells you the story of Rama, an Indian person and an Indian man, and what happened to him throughout his life. And there is extensive literature about medicine and body, and the two most famous ones that you probably heard of is the Kama Sutra, is the theory of love and how to make love, and Ayurveda is the kind of pseudo medicine therapeutics. This is a collection of techniques that you can use to keep your health in order. Very interesting is the literature and philosophy, especially Hinduistic and Buddhistic corpora are very, very large. And now I'm coming to my personally favorite point, and I suppose many of you are linguists there will be also quite interested in the linguistics that the Indians had. Indians had a very extensive linguistic tradition, and studying Sanskrit means at the same time studying linguistics. So if you learn this language, you will surely become a much better linguist. You will understand much more about phonology and morphology, and the reason for this lies in the old tradition of Indian grammarians that was established already around the 5th century before Christ, and it was established with this publication, Panini's publication, which also marks the start of classical Sanskrit. Because as I mentioned before, Sanskrit is basically a collection of many different dialects from many different times. And this 5th century publication, it kind of fossilized the written language, and it gave the mass of how to use Sanskrit possibly properly. And it is quite interesting because the structure of this grammar book is very precise. It consists of 3,959 sutras or strings translated into English, and you can see them here on the right. It looks like a text that runs without a stop, but actually, if you see this double danda or double stick, it appears all the time, and the sentences are quite short. So this is, for example, one of the sentences or one of the sutras, and they were also memorized by heart and not written down. They are very generative and descriptive in nature, and what I mean by that is that they analyze language in extreme detail, and Panini, what he did, he created a meta-language, so the whole linguistics meta-language to describe phenomena that are the grammatical constructions and morphological constructions that were used in Sanskrit. It is also a foundational text of the so-called Vyakarana scholarship, and this scholarship it was established in ancient India, because the ancient Indians they noticed that their language was changing, and they noticed that they could no longer understand their sacred knowledge written in the ancient Vedas. So they established a discipline to study this language, and for this reason, Panini has been called linguists in Europe the father of modern linguistics, and his work has not been discovered by the Western world until the 19th century, and this is quite remarkable, because it took the Europeans until the 19th century to understand as much as Panini did in the 5th century before Christ about grammar. So to illustrate what he understood, what Panini actually understood, I will make you a few examples. So this is not the whole system of sounds that Sanskrit has. It's only the plosives, so the stops, the sounds that you make when you make a closure in your mouth, and when you release this closure, you pronounce the sounds. And these stops, these special sounds, they are classified by a linguist according to the place of articulation. So the place where in your mouth exactly the stop occurs or the closure occurs. And according to this place in the mouth, we classify consonants into classes, into velar, palatal, retroflex, dental, labial, and all those consonants, all those stops are present in Sanskrit language. So Panini already analyzed all those sounds, And he put them in a system which was not arbitrary. So you can see here, he grouped them according to their pronunciation, according to their articulation and the way of pronouncing them. So he made groups of voiceless and voiced plosives, and he also analyzed them into further groups, into non-aspirated and aspirated. So the difference between non-aspirated and aspirated sounds is the this little kind of h sound that appears. So just to illustrate, this would be pronounced as ka, and this would be pronounced as ka. So this little h sound. And he also noticed that there are different nasal sounds in the classical Sanskrit, and he put this whole whole system, he put order into this whole system of sounds. So quite remarkable for that time. And grammar, he analyzed grammar, and he described this grammar. So one of the reasons for studying Sanskrit is an incredibly complex grammar of this language, but quite beautiful. You learn about vowel length because there is a opposition between long and short vowels in Sanskrit. You will learn about semi-vowels, so the vowels, they can either appear as consonants or as vowels, depending on where they are. You will learn about the rule of retroflexion pronouncing retroflex sounds. We in European languages don't have those sounds, but this is the typical d sound or t sound that you probably heard when an Indian person speaks English. Those kind of sounds that you can pronounce if you curl your tongue to the back, towards the back, and push it towards the top in your mouth. You will also learn about very many sandhi rules. This is the process of sounds changing according to what comes next. So sounds fitting to each other, depending on what comes next. An example from English would be the indefinite article. It can appear as a or n, depending on what comes next. So you say a pear, but you say an apple. There are lots of such rules in Sanskrit. You will learn a lot about morphology. So the term affix is very important. It's really important to understand what it is, because Sanskrit words, they are traced back to their original roots. And what you learn is a root and how to make a stem, and how to attach different affixes to the root to make a stem. Because depending on what kind of stem you have, you will have to attach different endings. And you can also attach preverbs, so special kind of prefixes that will modify the meaning of verbs. But there is also a very, very important thing, which is called ablaut. And this is a change of vowel. It's a vowel gradation inside of the root or inside of certain suffixes. And this system of ablaut, it is also present in English. For example, when you say sleep, slept, you change the vowel in the middle of the root. And Sanskrit has a lot of that. You will also learn about reduplication, about repeating a certain syllable to make new morphological forms, but also about composition. So making new words, making long words like in German, making words like Streichholz, Schächtelchen, so words that are combined of many smaller words. You will learn about different cases. The vocative case is, for example, something many in the European languages have lost. And Lithuanian has, for example, vocative case. Ukrainian has vocative case. Also Sanskrit has vocative case. And apart from vocative case, it has seven other cases. So it has retained all eight original Proto-Indo-European cases. It has also a separate grammatical category dual, means that you have separate endings of the words when you are talking about two things. So, for example, if you're talking about you and me and it's two persons, then you use dual. Or if you're talking about your hands or your eyes or your ears, so anything that comes in pairs, you would have to use dual. The verbal system is also quite complex, so I will not shock most of you with the term infinitive or imperative. Or maybe a few of you have heard about causatives, but I'm not sure if you've heard about the desiderative or the absolutive or the aorist or the optative. All those are separate grammatical categories in Sanskrit. And if you're wondering, what is this big space right now in the middle? What is going to come next? What kind of fancy grammatical term? Yeah, one of the things you have in Sanskrit is the future middle participle. And you can already guess if it's a participle that is in future and in middle voice, there are bound to be more than only this participle. Yes, there are present participles, there are active participles, passive participles, and so on. So just to illustrate, what is going on with all this terminology, I give you an example of a root, verbal root gam, which means to go, and what you can construct from it. So you can construct an infinitive with the help of a suffix. You just attach suffix tum, and a sandhi, an internal sandhi occurs, so you need to change the M to N. You can also attach different prefixes to this and change the meaning. So in English, you would need to use a separate word for that, but in Sanskrit, still this gam remains a part of the word. You can also attach up to three prefixes, in fact. So here you have pari, upa, and a. A blends with upa into a long a. And you again get a different word, different meaning. You can, of course, also attach different endings to form different tenses. So the present tense, I go, is formed with ami, and you can here you can see an example of dual. So if you're talking about two persons, there's a separate ending, and of course plural exists as well. So if you're talking about multiple people, you use again separate ending. For those of you who speak Latin, you will recognize the same ending, almost the same ending here. You have several past tenses, so it's not just one. In fact, it's three different past tenses that are made in very different ways. And you also have future tense. You can also formulate imperatives and optative cases with, here's this fancy desiderative form that many languages don't have, but Sanskrit can boast with that as well. And the absolutive form, you use these because Sanskrit has a tendency to only use one finite verb per sentence. So when you have several actions, you would use a different form, the absolutive form. Yeah, you can also make from those verbal roots nouns. This is a participle here, so you make a participle, it actually means gone, but here it acquired a different meaning, like dead, and you can form different nouns from verbal roots as well, so gatam, motion, gati, path, or you can attach more complex suffixes to make new words. So when Europeans discovered this complexity of, just having one verbal root and this whole tradition of learning languages, then they were quite astonished. And this person here, Sir William Jones, he was a philologist and he was working in India and he was studying Sanskrit. And he became famous because he had the presentation here. He was giving a talk in Calcutta in 1786. And what he said was, the Sanskrit language, whatever be its antiquity, is of a wonderful structure, more perfect than the Greek, more copious than the Latin, and more exquisitely refined than either, yet bearing to both of them a stronger affinity, both in the roots of verbs and the forms of grammar, than could possibly have been produced by accident. So strong indeed that no philologist could examine them all three without believing them to have sprung from the same common source, which perhaps no longer exists. So Sir William Jones was absolutely right about the fact that Sanskrit is related to all other languages. And what Western people did, they compared all different languages with each other, and they came up with this idea that they are related, and that a proto-language can be reconstructed from all of this. And they put them into trees, and this is one of those trees. And here, Sanskrit has a really, really small part here, because this tree tries to show the number of speakers, and Sanskrit is, of course, very, appears to be unimportant here. But in fact, Sanskrit was extremely important for the reconstruction of the Proto-Indo-European language. And here's an example of just the four cognates. I picked five, daughter, med, and men. And if you just compare those languages and look at the reconstructed form of the Proto-Indo-European, then you will see that that Sanskrit is quite close to the reconstructed form, and also, you know, those four words are attested in Sanskrit. Also, Lithuanian hasn't changed much, which is quite remarkable, because Lithuanian has not been codified as Sanskrit has been. But just to illustrate my point, you see that the words are haven't changed far from the original Proto-Indo-European. So now about how can you study Sanskrit? You will need, of course, studying materials. I will definitely not be able to mention all of them, but these are my favorite ones. First of all, you will need a grammar. And this is a wonderful book. It's a recent publication, Cambridge Introduction to Sanskrit. And it's a step-by-step introduction to Sanskrit with grammar points and very good exercises, lots of exercises, also original texts, passages from original texts. Wonderful grammar. Another book I would strongly suggest reading is the Bhagavad Gita. It's the most famous work of Sanskrit literature. It's a philosophical work. It's the last chapter of Mahabharata. And this particular publication is quite special because it has an interlinear word-for-word translation, and each word is translated in led back to its roots, and you can see what grammatical category it is exactly. And this is quite helpful, especially for beginners. And if you are a historical linguist like myself, and if you're interested in the past of the languages, and if you're also interested in cognates, then I really recommend this book, Sanskrit Grammatik mit Sprachvergleichen Erläuterungen, by Manfred Meyerhofer. He was an excellent historical linguist, and although the publication is quite old and it's not up to date when it comes to the theory of Proto-Indo-European, it's fantastic. What I also recommend, those online resources, an excellent collection of digital dictionaries, and available not only for English but also French and German. Just visit this website. And you will see it's a little bit hard to navigate, but there is very good help there. This website is also very recommendable. It's a step-by-step introduction into Sanskrit through stories, so it's not so heavy on grammar. You read very, it's great at reading mostly. You read the simple stories and it becomes more difficult. And then this website, the next one, Learn Sanskrit, has very good grammar. So everything you want to know about grammar of Sanskrit, you can find it there. And the Sanskrit channel on YouTube, check it out if you're interested in learning Sanskrit through videos. Another recommendation of mine is Punyakoti. It's a movie that just came out last year. Wonderful story. And it is the first movie in Sanskrit language. Translating text is a very important practice, as you might have noticed, because Sanskrit is really all about texts. This might be quite a challenge, especially for beginners. So here are a few tips for you how to translate text. It differs a little bit from translating other classical languages like Latin, because mostly Sanskrit is written in Devanagari script. Not always other scripts have been used for Sanskrit. Sanskrit has no special script of its own. It employed different scripts. So here, Devanagari, and the second line features the transliteration, the official standard of transliterating Devanagari text into Latin form. And if you compare the second line with the third line, then you will notice some differences. First, there are spaces between words, like here and here, but also certain things have changed, like this O appears here as A, and also this O appears here as A. And those are the very many Sandhi rules that Sanskrit uses. So you wrote language the way you would speak. You wrote it very close to the sound. That's why, in order to recognize the grammatical categories, the grammatical forms of the words, you first need to kind of puzzle your way through those Sandhi forms. And when you've done that, the next challenge is to decide what grammatical categories you have. And that's not so difficult if you have a good grammar, but recognizing the actual meaning is quite challenging, because some Sanskrit words have so many different meanings. So this is my technique. This is how I translate texts, and I can absolutely recommend you this table kind of approach. And if you do need help with studying this language, if you would like some guidance, then I can absolutely recommend the study program at the university where I'm working and where I receive my training. You can study there BA and MA Historische Linguistik. The studies are in German, and in BA alone you learn apart from Sanskrit three other ancient languages. It's a wonderful study program. I recommend it to every one of you. And if you're not the university kind of person, you can also contact me. I offer private tutoring. You can write me an email, or you can find me on Twitter or on my website. I offer individual approach. I offer you personalized materials, and I try to read original texts with you as soon as possible. So you receive a little bit of training in grammar, and then we proceed on reading original texts, and I offer classes in English, German, Russian, Ukrainian, Lithuanian, or Spanish. And thank you very much for all your attention. Thank you very much. Namaste. And now it's time for questions. I'm really, really looking forward to all of your questions. I can see here there are quite a few in chat. I will start at the beginning. Sanskrit is a dead language, but is it known how it was spoken? So yes, it is very well known how it was spoken, because Panini, in his grammar, described the sound of Sanskrit so precisely that we are able to reconstruct the sound of it. And in fact, it's been done so well, we're not, even with the modern technology, even when we are now able to analyze the anatomy of our vocal tract, we are still, our modern science agrees on the pronunciation of what Panini has analyzed. So yes, we are quite sure about how Sanskrit sounded. Next question. How easy is it for the speakers of Latvian and Lithuanian to learn Sanskrit? Is there really some kinship between the Baltic languages and Sanskrit? Yes, well, the kinship, there exists kinship, and the kinship is through the Proto-Indo-European language. So originally, both Sanskrit and Lithuanian and Latvian as well, they developed from the Proto-Indo-European language. But then they kind of separated and they went different directions. And there are several theories about linguistic change and how it happens. And what you do as a historical linguist, you establish rules that you call them sound laws, and according to those laws, you can analyze how sounds developed into other sounds systematically throughout the whole language. And there are certain rules that are the same. For example, the very famous Ruki rule is the same for Baltic languages and Slavic languages and Indo-Iranian languages. But there are also certain words that sound the same or very, very similar. But if you would learn Sanskrit and you know Lithuanian, you would still have to start from the beginning. And it might be helpful because you will have easier time memorizing vocabulary, but it will certainly not be very easy or much easier than for a person, let's say, speaking Ukrainian or Czech. It will be most definitely easier for you to study Sanskrit than to a speaker of English, because of the grammatical categories, because of the many cases that Lithuanian has retained. Latvian has developed a little bit further, so it's not as archaic in grammar as Lithuanian is. And certain endings, certain case endings are similar, and also you form the future tense with the S sound in both in Lithuanian and in Sanskrit. So you will recognize certain patterns, but you will probably need to a person to pinpoint out those similarities, because I'm not sure if as a non-linguist you will be able to spot them. I hope that answers your question. Next question. How many dead languages do you understand? Thank you very much for this question. This is a very difficult question to answer, because learning dead languages is not quite as learning modern spoken languages. So I don't speak dead languages, and I usually don't spend time pronouncing them. I pronounce the words while learning vocabulary, but I have no way of practicing them. And that leads to the problem that when I read a text in a dead language, it's not like I see, of course, I understand this. It is more of a hard work. You sit there with a grammar and with a dictionary, and you search for the correct ending and the correct form and the correct root. I'm able to translate with a dictionary Sanskrit, old Persian, old Church Slavonic, old Lithuanian, Hittite, hieroglyphic Luwian, old High German, but a little bit worse. And I think that's it already. Next question. Is Panini's book translated to any languages? Yes, it is. There's bound to be a Hindi translation. I think there are multiple bigger Indian languages, modern Indian languages, will have a translation. There is also a translation into German. There is extensive analysis of Panini's work in German language, written in German language, also English. I'm not sure about French, but I assume that there is also a French translation. I can have a look after the presentation, and if you'd like, you can contact me by email, and I will tell you about the different translations. According to you, how long does it take to learn Sanskrit and understand the ancient scriptures and texts? So in my experience, it differs largely. The university course for trained linguists lasts 1 year, and in 1 year, in two semesters, you learn the whole of grammar. So you learn to navigate through grammar books and to be able to recognize all of the grammatical forms. You're also trained in using dictionary, And the classes are once a week. So once a week of 1 year, and an average university student is able to do that. If you're a trained linguist already, and if you have some knowledge of other ancient languages, especially Greek is of big help, and Latin, then you will have easier time. So one of my students, he's particularly good at learning ancient tongues. He actually mastered half of Sanskrit grammar in 2.5 months, and we started translating translating original texts, very complicated philosophical scriptures, in Buddhistic scriptures of Nagarjuna, and he was amazing. So he was very fast in 2.5 months. But that's an exception. I think most of the people would need at least half a year, and after half a year, slowly, step by step, I introduce people to original texts. And after 1 year, you're able to understand, read, and use, especially with the help of grammar, you will be able to find your way around, also without without external help. Next question: how similar is Vedic Sanskrit to its contemporary Indo-European languages like Hittite and Mycenaean Greek? So, just to clarify, Vedic Sanskrit is the earliest form of Sanskrit. So Sanskrit is a kind of umbrella term for very many kinds of ancient Indian languages. And Vedic Sanskrit is, as the name already says, is the language of Vedas, so the earliest books. And how similar? Well, you can certainly see similarities, and if you compare cognates, you immediately see, okay, those languages are related. But the thing is that when Indo-Iranian languages split from the Proto-Indo-European, one major change happened. The vowels were merged. The vowels, the original vowels A, E, and O were merged all into A. So what you get is a picture when you compare Greek, and you see you have all those S and E's and O's and O's and so on. You will always have an A or A in Sanskrit, and also in other Indo-Aryan languages and in Iranian languages. So this kind of disturbs the whole understanding, but the cognates they look extremely similar. Next question: my most encounter with Sanskrit is Buddhist songs. Are there people who can converse in Sanskrit? Yes, just as Latin, there are people who are able to converse in Latin. Same as with Sanskrit, there are some people who are able to speak Sanskrit. I haven't met any yet, and it's not common in the West. I think all of those who I've heard of come from either Nepal or India. Next question. Approximately how many people use this language? So in India, according to Ethnologue, as you've seen on one of my slides, there are over 5 million people who use this language, and by use it means scholars who read Sanskrit, or also monks who are interested in the study of scriptures use this language. Outside of India, it's very difficult to say. So around the countries around India, especially north of India, where the Buddhist tradition the Buddhist practice is still very common. And there are quite a few people using this language, but I'm not sure about the absolute numbers. And in the West, it's not very common. It was very difficult to find a place to study Sanskrit. So there are some universities offering courses, and you know, I'm talking about universities because this is usually where people who use Sanskrit are grouped. I'm not sure about the numbers. It hasn't happened often to me that I met someone who uses Sanskrit outside of university. Next question. Do you know about the Sanskrit-speaking village in India, Mathura in Karnakata? Yes, I know. I've heard about this village. I would love to visit this village myself. I have a dream once in my life to go to India and study Sanskrit, you know, according to their Indian tradition, because their philologists have slightly different methods, especially if you compare it to the training I received as a historical linguist. Yes, I would love to go there and try to speak Sanskrit myself. And I think the last question, because we're almost running out of time. Do you agree that studying classical Sanskrit makes Pali understandable without extra study? What about Vedic? I haven't studied Pali myself, but I know for a fact that that it makes it easier. Of course, it is also easier to study Spanish or Italian if you have knowledge of Latin. So yes, it will make easier. It's also much easier to study Hindi and if you have some knowledge of Sanskrit. So another reason to study Sanskrit, if you're interested in other Indo-Aryan tongues, Sanskrit makes it much easier to understand the rest and study the rest. Yeah, that was the last question. I don't see any further questions. I thank you very much once again. And if you do happen to have some further questions, please do get in touch. Don't hesitate. I'm looking forward to your emails. And if you don't have any questions, then I would be just happy to connect and have a conversation about Sanskrit or any other languages you're interested in. Thank you very much and bye-bye.